Adolescence is a very critical time to act. Think about the fact that four major risk factors for cardiovascular diseases, that is a major killer in adult life, are linked to the behaviors that start or are established in adolescence. I am talking about the levels of physical activity, nutrition, alcohol, and tobacco use. Some of the adolescents will make healthy choices, but others will make unhealthy choices. They will start as experimental behaviors, but then can become lifelong habits. Our challenge is to ensure that the healthy choices are easy and the unhealthy choices are difficult, expensive, inaccessible. Another reason why adolescence is a very critical period to act is that many health problems manifest themselves for the first time in adolescence. For example, half of all mental health problems start before the age of 14, and many go undetected and untreated. This is not a trivial omission. Depression is the third leading cause of ill health in adolescents, and suicide is the third leading cause of death in older adolescents. In 2017, we have launched the Guidance for Accelerated Action for the Health of Adolescents. We call it AHA Guidance. And by producing this document, we wanted that the users, the countries, the governments, have not only the AHA moment in terms of AHA, now I know what the problem is, but also AHA, now I know what the solution is. This is why the guidance is not only about facts and figures, as important as they are to know where exactly to act, but it's a compilation of most up-to-date evidence of what works. Evidence-based interventions across a whole spectrum of conditions, such as mental health and substance use, intentional and unintentional injuries, sexual and reproductive health and HIV, communicable, non-communicable diseases. The partnership that was created while producing this guidance sets a new era in global adolescent health. And this pays off now. In every country that used the AHA guidance to inform national action, consortia between governments and development partners and civil society organizations and young people were formed to steer actions forward. And this is a very promising sign. In past, agencies tended to work in isolation, each looking after a particular disease or problem, HIV in adolescents, contraception in adolescents, nutrition in adolescents. And what we hope now is that the focus will change from a disease to the adolescent, the person in the entirety of his or her needs. There are many reasons why governments have to be involved in adolescent health and development and investing more in adolescent health. One is that investing in adolescent health is a very good investment, as simple as that. Evidence is growing that not only benefits from investing in adolescent health will be for the adolescent health in short and long term, but the entire society and economy will benefit from those investments. For an investment of just under $5 per capita in adolescent sexual, reproductive, and mental health, the benefit-to-cost ratio will be 10-1. But for those pragmatic ones that think in terms of political cycles, let's not forget that older adolescents vote. Today, we have the number of adolescents larger than ever, and it is expected, the predictions are, that the cohort of adolescents will still be growing until 2050. Those are large numbers of voters today and tomorrow. Adolescents and young people can be a very positive driving force for the society, but only if families and governments invest in their health and education and provide better new economic opportunities for them.